Yes, welcome again to our second session of viewing the back office. And last time we had discussed shortly about the back office, and I took you through how you can monitor the point of sale through the back office. And we saw how you can do CAP results and how you can do, you can check on CAP masters, how you can check on customers, and how also you can view the customer outstanding via the back office. Now today I want us just to go through another session of the back office, and we will check on a few elements, especially one is the controls that are available at the back office. So those controls are the ones that we need to check on, and I will take you through how to set up a back office. Okay, so as usual, that is the interface, and let me just enlarge it a little bit. So that is the interface, and that is how it looks like for those who saw it last time. So this is what we discussed last time. This is one of the modules called the POS, and this is what relates with the entire point of sale. And please, if you want to know more, you can refer to the last tutorial that we had. So you can look at now, this one is the another module, the inventory. We will also discuss on this, and we will touch on this today so that you'll have a strong understanding of what actually is all about. Now, how to set up the back office. This is where you offer rights, like when you want to give rights to specific individuals, okay? And this is where you give rights through the back office, okay? That is at the branch. So you just say that, and then you click the setup, just like the way I've just clicked the setup. At times it stays a little bit for it to open because it is a server enabled functionality. So it has actually to communicate with the server so that it may be in a position of to open. So as we are waiting for it, as you can see, it has already populated. And you can see this is where you define your company's information. If you want the name of your company, like as of me, the name of the company is Aura Supermarket. And then the branch code, maybe it is branch one. That is the first branch. Then, okay, you can pull those revenue headers, VAT registrations and all that. With your PIN number also, you can indicate there. And then the short name of your company. Not necessarily short name, but you can just put the name in which you want it to appear in your receipts. Now, most of the time you'll find the field at which the receipts are designed may not actually be able to accommodate or maybe take the entire characters of the wording. So that is where now they give you an option of maybe you can put a short name there. So maybe instead of a supermarket, maybe you can say SPKM. Okay, let me just put in caps. You can say SPMKT. That is okay, they will know it is Aura Supermarket or something like that. So just for the sake of the receipt, may not actually, you know, define or take the entire wordings as it is. But if it takes, then that is okay. But there are some of those tiny small receipts that may not actually be able to take because of the setting of the fielding. But those fielding can be adjusted, not a problem. And okay, some other clients will prefer it that way. And of course, here you can set your address. You can also set your address 2. You can also put the address 3 and then update. So this information will always be appearing in each and every document. Like let's say if you raise an LPO, you raise a quotation, or you raise a GRN. So these are some of the information that will be appearing to your in your documents. That is at the top right of every document. And of course, here you can put your logos. You just simply say update image. Well, once you click that, then it will take you to where maybe you filed your images, and then you can select your images. Let's just see here. You see, now it takes me here. Then I'll go and maybe you can go back to your desktop and then find where you've set your, or maybe where you stored your image, or could be your pictures, like for example, as for me, let me say if this will be okay. So let me just take this image randomly, and you see that he updated the logo, and that is where the logo will come in now. So once any document I raise, it will appear with that logo within the back office. So this is where you put your company information. And then right here at the pause, this is where now you identify, like these are some of the footers. You can see here it is the foot in receipt, 25 characters per line. So like this is what appears in your receipt, like at the bottom of your receipt, it will appear, these wordings will appear. You can put any other wording because they are editable. You can put any other wording, but most of the time these wordings, we put them here just beforehand. They are inbuilt for you, so, or if you want them changed, you can simply just come here and change the wording. You can see now this is the foot character definition of each and every wording. So you can define currency here. If you are in Tanzania, you can put in Kenya shilling, you are in Tanzanian shillings. If you are in wherever, you can put, depends with the currency that you are transacting with. So you can put the transaction there, the currency initials there. And then receipts bold, those entries with less than profit margin, zero profit margin, here the receipt will put that bold. And then of course show running receipts here. If you want to see the running receipts, this one also it will show you there. This one is right at the point of sale. If you want to put more settings, you just come there, branch type. If the amount, now here I've put cost price. If you want, I've put cost price because if it is a branch setup and maybe some items are being moved, if it is a branch setup and then items are being moved from the headquarter, okay, they are moved from the headquarter to the branch level, and maybe the headquarter does not want to charge the branch. So what happens? This is what happens. You just set here so that the stock that will be received at the branch, it will not be charged by the headquarter. So they will receive everything at the cost. At the cost price. So that is how you set. Now if you want the branches to be charged, okay, like a selling price and all that, you can also indicate here so that when you transfer a stock to a specific branch or to a certain branch, then it is like you're selling it to them, so they will be charged for a certain amount. But now this one, if you don't, then you just send it to them at the cost, or they will receive items at the cost price. So I'll leave it there here. And then you can enable StoreX. If you have some StoreX, you can actually enable it, or you can even enable shelf so that the system will start reading the shelf stock that is being, what is being sold and what is coming out of the shelf to the point of sale. So it will actually be indicating there. So you have actually the branch CAP outstanding limit you can put there. Definitely this one, normally it is -1. We just put -1 because there is no branch that is being charged. That is as far as the setup of the HQ mode. But if it is a standalone mode, here it can just be like that. Now if it is a branch that buys things from the headquarter at a selling price, then if whatever they take when the headquarter is invoicing them, then definitely here you will not put it like that. Then it has to remain to be one so that the branch can be able, you are able to see the outstanding that the branch has as pertains to the headquarter. So the single CAP customer outstanding limit, also the same. That one we've just put it that way because this branch is interconnected with the headquarter. And then branch stock limit, this is where also you put the limit of the branch. But as of now, this branch does not have a limit because I'm using the demo version. But for for companies, it is advisable they put branch limit, because at times you cannot transfer stock or just keep pushing stock the branch, and maybe those stocks are not performing, or maybe you never know, you don't know how the branch is really performing. So you have to put up to a certain value, number of stock limit to a specific branch, so that if it reaches a specific amount, then the branch will stop receiving stock from the headquarters until the stock that is there is fully sold and all that. So this is where you set your branch in connection to the POS, so that you can really control the functions and operations of your branches here. And of course, now this one, when you come here, this is where you set the ESD from the TILS. You can set your ESD. This is where you do the ESD, the ESD IP address. You put the IP address here, and then you put the ESD's serial number. That is the device serial number, you indicate it there. And then after that, you do the enabling. Enabling, you simply put a tick here. So once you've put a tick here, then the ESD will be active in your branch, and then you save the ESD table here, and then the ESD will be very active in your branch, which means it is ready now to operate with the TILS. And then also here, you can put the global setting, simply the pathway where the ESD is reading, and of course where it can put its backup. So normally the temp folder is actually created at the drive C in your desktop, so that every transaction that is taking place, then the backup is actually being taken there, and then of course you save. So this is where you do the setting. So once you've set this, then it means your back office and your front office is now ready to start functioning, to work. So the settings that I showed you at the front office can work only if you've completed the settings at the back office here. So this is what normally happens here. Then when it comes to users, this is where now you can determine the users. And how do you create users? When you want to create a user, you simply click this user here, and then you come, you say new. And once you say new, maybe you are creating a user. Let's say I'm creating a name, Juma. Okay, let me say I'm creating this guy here, Juma Hamisi. Then I will give him the password. Let's say I'll give him the password 123. And then maybe if I can hide the password, I do that. Then it is always good you set these passwords. It is always good that you ensure that you set the expiry days, because this guy, you never know. He may be in the company today, tomorrow he may not be there. So after maybe 30 days, that is when they will keep on renewing their passwords after every 30 days. Once you put the tick there. Then of course, if he's a staff, you simply come here and then you select his name from the staff, so that he may be able to use the biometrics. That is if you are using both the HR and you are using the smartman. So from the HR data, it will pull the name of that staff here, and you are able to indicate there, so that he may be recognized. So that whenever he wants to use the biometrics, remember the biometrics are registered at the HR mode. So let me say, since I don't have Juma Hamisi in my HR mode, I will just indicate this guy. So you can see, once I select the staff, the picture comes. This is exactly what happens at the HR mode. You pick even the image of the staff. So then I say accept. Once I say accept, the name will be registered here. And then every biometrics functions, everything that is registered at the HR will be here. So that if Juma is a supervisor, then all his biometrics will be also be registered at the point of sale, so that he will be able to use the biometrics instead of just typing passwords and all that stuff. So that is what it is. So if I want to give Juma rights, you see now, you can see here, if I select the name Juma, he doesn't have any rights here. Okay, so he doesn't have any rights to operate in the front office, neither does he have any rights to operate in the back office. So, but if you look, if I select the admin, you see the admin has rights. That is 562, rights granted out of 562. So he has all the rights. So exactly when I select this name, Emmanuel here, also Emmanuel has 557 rights granted of 562. Okay, so Emmanuel has fewer rights here as compared to the admin. So if I select Juma and I want Juma also to have rights, I will simply select these rights. If I want him to have all the rights, I'll just come here and say select all. Okay, so once I tick select all and then I update. So once I update, then Juma will have all the rights that he has. Okay, he has all the rights that he's supposed to have. Likewise, also if I want to give him the rights so that he may be able to operate in the StoreX and access what is there, also all the stores, I can choose to give him the rights of only one store and update, or choose to give him the rights of all the stores. Okay, so you can give somebody the rights of specific stores, or you can give them only rights of all the stores. But it is advisable that you give specific rights to specific people in those stores. Okay, so once you do this, once you've done all the rights, you've given the rights, and maybe let me say if it is workshop, at times you are given even workstation rights, but now I've not set any workstation rights here, it's for now. But if you want to set, you can simply add, but now I've not set. So once I've set these rights, you've done the settings within the back office, what happens, you simply just update. You click up here and then you say update. So you can see what it's saying here. It says the stamp updated. Front office of this branch should get the latest information within a few minutes. So whatever you do at the back office, once you click here, definitely it will update the front office automatically. So in terms of the users, so those guys that you've set rights here, they will be able now also to access the front office with the same rights that you've given them. But if you've not actually assigned them to access the front office here, if you've not put any tick here, then they will not be able to access the front office. But if you give them the ticks of a front office, mostly cashiers, we give them rights to do with the front office. We don't give them rights to do with the back office, Storex, or email services. We just focus on the front office here. And then we say maybe we want him to check on wherever. This is where now you can define what you want them to have and what you don't want them to have. Like, for example, you may not need them to do deletion of any entries, which is very dangerous for a cashier to delete anything. So these are some of the rights you need to sieve when you are assigning a specific right to a specific cashier within the back office. Okay, so that is how you can be able to assign rights and do the setup of the entire back office so that it can be able to work with the front office. Otherwise, thank you very much. If you have any question, please make sure you give a comment there, or maybe you can reach me through the number 0727-625-340. Or if you know the Aspire office, please, you can reach even the support, Aspire support guys. They also be able to assist you in doing this. Otherwise, thank you very much, and we'll see you in the next video, whereby we are going to discuss more on how to add data in the back office. Thank you very much.